space, then we create a project in that, a source file, then it is like we can include files or we can add them directly, physically we can copy them. By either we can link them or we can put them. So we'll add files, we'll create target configuration, and then in some cases, like suppose you are working on a project that is not your project, rather someone has worked earlier and you need to continue with that. So how to actually add the existing projects so that you don't have to do all the repetition hard work of configuring new projects. So what we used to do is we had a project and we used to just change the source code file. We didn't tamper with all the other files that are given to it, because at times what happened is it used to give us various errors which used to take days to solve. Okay, one more thing, the Code Composer Studio version that we are using right now is CCS version 4, but there are version 5 and 6 available, and personally I feel that version 6 is the best among 3, because there has been many issues with version 4, because it gives target errors, it gives .EBSS errors that you will see. And whatever I discussed till now was what we are going to do right now before break. During this session only, we'll also be telling you how to run simulations on it. So once you all get familiar, once you write down the steps of how to configure it, then we'll show you a demo in which one will be emulation by me and a simulation by my friend. And then you will be given time to actually work on your simulation environments. In the afternoon session, that is after the break, we'll be giving you a demo of how to use the ADCs of the DSP that we are working upon right now. We'll also give you some demos. Then we'll have a set of 7 experiments that we'll perform in the afternoon session, along with the 3 emulation practicals that we will do. Now, for emulation, it is mandatory to connect our DSP to computer, and we don't have the sufficient number of boards. We just have around 5. So around 3 to 4 groups can work on emulation, while others can work on the 7 experiments that we have designed. I'll tell that in the afternoon what are the programs. So right now let's go. This was just a brief so that you all remain connected to the session. So now is the time to get started. Before this, we have also created an installation video. We are providing both the versions 6 and 4 along with you all. You can take it in your pen drive. The installation video will give you step by step explanation of how to install your CCS. Okay. Apart from this, you all will require some folders. Make sure you take it from us. This is a demo folder. Just a minute, it's giving some problem with the projector. Okay. So this is the demo project. It has the CCS for setup file, CCS6. Then we have created some demo projects that you all will work today. We have also given you other information that are required. The readme file will have step-by-step points of what I will explain in this session. Make sure you take this. And after installation, the first thing that you all need to do is this folder, TIDCS. This has to be copied in your C drive of whichever computer you are working. If this is not there, none of the projects will work. The reason is, whenever you all will create a project, as I will show, the include option contains a file path to all the header files that will be required. So if you are if you all have used C, you will use hash include stdio.h. By default, these files are available in a folder in your computer which are accessible anywhere. But when you work on any other programs, the you all are aware, I guess, that all the header files must be within the same project that you are working. It is just like a general concept of classes and projects. So this has to be there in C drive. This is the important point. Please make a note of it. And now we move on to CCS. This is the icon. Depending on the machine that you all are working, CCS is a heavy software and it takes time to load. The machine that I am using is heavily loaded. The PCs that you all are working are new, relatively, and are empty. Hence, it will be faster. In your home PCs, it might work even slower. sections, this is the point where the first difference comes. When you have already created a workspace, you all are aware of what workspace is right now. This is the workspace that I was working on right now. That is today, 2nd July 15, I had created this. So I will click on OK if I already working on it. But as of now, since I am giving a demo, what I will do is I will tell you how to create a workspace at first step. So click on Browse. Click on, say I want to create on D, I want to create a new folder. Okay, so click on New Folder. Give your name or whatever workspace you want to give. Say mine is Vrajesh. Okay, and I'll click on the folder. I must click on D, New Folder, Vrajesh. And then OK. So this will take you to the first screen of your CCS. That will be a welcome screen. So in the folders that we will provide, we have given you a whole lot of examples, which include flash memory examples. You can program it in your flash. We have given you there are also videos available on TI website themselves on how to use Code Composer as well. But since we have worked on them, we can give you an insight of how it is. So let's directly get started. From here, you all each one of you must note down points how to create a new workspace. First, click on File, New. CCS project. Now give your project name. It need not be the same name, it can be anything. Next. Now in project type, I am showing you a demo of emulation. The steps for simulation are different. So put a header that these are the steps for emulation. Okay, in the continuing section we will also show you the steps of simulation. The difference will be over here. Right now for emulation click on C2000. Okay, and then next. If you all have been working on projects, it will show a list over here. You all can include them, but as of now, since this is a new workspace, I don't have any. Next. So it has two time next. Then the device variant. In device variant, put TMS320C28XX, and it has two options, that is XX interprets multiple processor of the same family, and we are going to select our processor that I have given the name TMS320F28335. If you all are working on separate DSPs, you will have say C6000, select accordingly, okay? Finish. So this will give you a basic project, and as you can see, you have nothing right now, it's blank. So the first thing is target configuration. Click on New. Okay, what I did is, click on the project, right click, New. Project, on the project, right click, New. And target configuration file. Now here you can give any name, but what is essentially important is the extension. You all are aware what extensions are, right? They are used to indicate type of file. As you will see, if I don't put an extension, this will not accept it. So .ccxml is the extension that is required for each target configuration of your device. Put any name you want, I am keeping it as it is. Finish. So now you have determined that you want to create a target configuration. Let's select the processor that is our target. So this is important. Texas Instruments XDS100V1 USB emulator. This is actually the emulator name of the one that we are using, proprietary one, XRC. Now here you have to write the device name, TMS T20F28335, and then select. With me?
What's the difference between simulator and emulator?
Okay, just as I complete my this topic, my friend will tell you a detailed explanation of what is the difference between simulator and emulator, and also between normal programmers and a JTAG program. Okay. Good. With me now?
Yeah.
You want me to repeat any part? This is important. Everyone is done? Save. By double clicking you can maximize windows, common sense. Now again right click new, and this time we need a editor, we need a place where we can write a code. So that is a source file. Again, as you can see, the file name is empty. Even if I type, it is still giving me some error. It means that at this place also it is essential to give the extension. Suppose I give try 1, it is still giving me some kind of error that I am not interested in. File extension, I guess. So dot C. At this point in time it is not mandatory that you all can write only C program, because till now in industry there are people who are working on assembly language, and it has an added advantage over the C. Since C is a high language, there are multiple issues that are solved when we use assembly. But then that's a tedious work, because to write a simple code to generate sign, it would take around one page. If you all have worked on assembly, you all know how C is efficient. So we can put CC, error is gone. I can put ASM. ASM is assembly. Even that will work. Okay, I can have assembly files, I can have C files as well. I prefer C. And then finish. You can actually browse your C programs. When in simulator mode, all the programs that you have run compile on your C compiler, C IDEs, can actually run as it is, and we will demonstrate that as well. You can browse that and bring it, but I'll create a new one and finish. Now the next step is to again go to project, right click, go to properties now. Okay. Now C, C++ build. So we'll get this kind of pop-up. C, C++ build. Now there are two major options, C2000 compiler and linker. First let's go to linker, basic options. C2000 linker, basic options. Click on it. Now you are having the option for stack size and heap size. As of now, why, what is not going to be answered. Just follow blindly, 0x400. I can just tell that 0x is for hexadecimal, you are aware of it. And 400 is the size. Okay, click apply. Now scroll up to C2000 compiler. In that, we have include options. Now, remember I told you we have to enter the link C, TIDCS in C drive. This is where it will come. Now there is a small icon over here, type of text file with a plus, green plus, and it will give you a pop-up where you have to type your path. Now in the folder that we provide in demo, there is a text file with file path. Just copy this. And paste. Should I repeat this?
Yes.
Cancel. You all know how to come to this point?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Click on add. You can make a note, it is green sign wala plus. Green color wala plus. It will give you a pop-up. Now, we have provided you with a demo folder. It has file path. This is the demo folder that everyone will have after this session. It has a text file known as file path. Okay. Double click on it, you will get two file paths. You select the first, copy it, go back, paste it. Okay. You will see a path has been included. This is just like linking your project to the header files that are included in that folder so that you don't have to type the codes again. It's like code reusability. Now again add, and now this time the second file path. Essentially both are same, but depending on the nomenclature we have avoided ambiguity for different operating machines. Okay, and then okay. So now you have two apart from the basic root include. Apply and OK. So now you have a C file, target configuration file, include file, and these are the two parts that you all have included. This is one way of doing. Now what happens is, many a times, since you all are using it for the first time, there might be errors that this file is not being accessed, unable to access files, or at times target configuration problem. To avoid this, there's another method to do this. The steps are, in the demo folder, there is a folder called include. Open that. Now, select all files, copy them, go back to your IDE. And then right click on your project and paste them. So you will see all the header files. See DSP2A3 3X ADC.underscore.CALASM. All these are files that will be required. Why? Because in Atomega 32, I'm giving the example because it's relevant to you all. In Atomega 32, you didn't require initialization of many variables. But since DSP is a very complex chip, you all will need to configure its clock. It can operate at 150 MHz, you can even reduce its clock speed. We want to use the default settings, and hence we are using the files that are already provided, okay? You can also go modify, there are no more than simple files, but we are using the basic ones. Now, what are optional files in this? ADC, first, second, third are required only if you are operating or using ADC, which in general most DSP applications will require, and hence we have given it over here. This CPU timer, this is also kind of required in almost all projects because we prefer real-time operating systems. So this CPU timer is used to initialize it. We can even adjust the clock of CPU timer apart from its timer value, that is after how many microseconds to do it. And other files below should not be hampered because they are mandatory files that are required, like global variable definition. Now what this file has, it has all the file, in this you are aware that we actually require binary files to load on your device, but whenever you refer in this IDE, it will be having some name, say CPU Rex, CPU register dot, means inside that CPU register I want to access which field. Now DSP in itself does not know what CPU regs is, so this file global variable definition will link your word, physical human readable word, to machine understandable format, okay. Similarly you have PyCTRL, these are for your priority assignments. Then you have system control, which does basic operations of initialization, and then this is optional, microsecond delay function. this is written in assembly. So now you will having a whole all lot of files that you will require for any project, and I consider this as a basic project that you all should start with in order to avoid any kind of errors. And I prefer you are working on Code Composer version 6 so that the target configuration error is less and it's more stable than CCS4, because from past 1 year we have been using CCS4. Now we have shifted on to 6. Also this IDE, you can see there are tools, graphs, image analyzer, RTA. These are something which are possible because of emulation concept. Whenever you run a program, you have a total control of chip, each and every component of it. So actually when you pause, you can run and pause your program like you did do in a multimedia file. This is not a ordinary thing that's available to all microprocessors. I can run my program, I can allow it to operate for some cycles, I can pause and check what are the states of internal registers. So if I have created a buffer of 250 and I am intending to store a sine wave in it, or say simply a triangular wave in it, then I can run, pause. I can pause. At this time, entire operation on this DSP chip will halt and everything, every register, every memory element will be transferred back to my PC, where to this ID. And from this ID, I can actually read all the values. It will be shown in the continuing part of this session. I'm not going to focus on that. With this point, you all are ready to work on projects. Now, just to give a demo of one project which will be explained a little later, I'll again go to the demo folders. Here we have demo codes. We have a demo project. In case you have some problem but it's not getting sorted, then you can use this demo project to create your own projects, okay? But that will require the concept of importing a project that I will show you right now. Before that, go to demo projects. Sorry, demo codes. LED blink I am taking. Any. You can take any. Select all, copy, go back to your IDE. Now this is try1.c, my actual editor where I am typing my code. I will paste the entire code over here. The details will be explained later on. This is just to show what is happening. I want to show you the state of DSP right now. See, these LEDs are constantly on. You can see, right, it's on. And right now it's being programmed. Now let's get back to our this. How to run your program? The first step is to build it. How? Go to projects. Build active project. Projects, build active project. The time taken depends on your operating system and machine load, but this would be relatively faster than debugging, which is the next step. This is your console where all the operations that the IDE performs, the results of which will be thrown out over here. So right now you all can see that there is no red mark. Everything is black, indicating normal text. In case of errors, which I can demonstrate if required, there will be some red marks. Now those are classified into two types, warnings and errors. If they are warnings, ignore them, no problem. But if they are errors, they need to be sorted, otherwise you cannot go ahead. So I am ready to debug this. This bug icon, it's bug, now you debug. This takes a relatively long time. Got it. Now this is your debug screen. here you have this play button, run. You run it. So the main thread, if you all are aware of thread concept, is running. And at this point in time on my DSP, you can see the LED is glowing, they are blinking. So the program is right now of a binary counter. If you all can guess, it's a binary counter. The first one is blinking, and so on. So what I did is debug and run. Okay, as I was exploring the features of this, you all can see this, it is working right now, continuously, right? What will happen if I pause it? Will the program be erased from my chip? No. But will the LEDs be blinking? That's right. If I run it again, LEDs will blink. Now, after pause, if I run, will the program execute from the point where it halted, or will it go, it will start afresh? Where you halt, it will start from that point. So this is important if you are using some system, says the one which we are using. We are controlling an induction heater using, we are actually implementing the algorithm to control an induction heater on this chip. So if you want to say in the first 5 microseconds, I want to operate on an internal signal so that I get a stable output waveform. And then I want to take my actual output of my induction heating load or any output. I take it using my ADC and then I give it to my program. So I can actually do the switching and analyze the state before and after switching. Okay? So that it can give me an idea of stability. What will happen if I, okay, one important thing over here. Whenever you close your Code Composer Studio or you remove your DSP, this is essential that you click over here, terminate and remove. It is like a live streaming of your DSP on your computer. So it is essential to terminate the connection and remove your device from it for safety. If this is not done, it might create instability. In that case, close Code Composer and restart again. Okay, at this point in time when I terminate remove, will the code still be there? Yes? No, it won't be there. No, this has not been burned on flash. If it is burned on flash, then it would be retained. So it is essential that whenever you are working on a code, keep in mind that if it is not flashed, you cannot work. Suppose right now the LEDs are not blinking. But if it had been flashed, then as soon as I connect it to any power supply via USB or by the power supply pin that is given, it will automatically execute the program. So today's session that you all will practice, it won't be flashed. So as soon as you terminate remove it, it is like when you are you do it for the next time, you have to load the program again. But since this ID does it for itself, you all don't have to worry about loading or demo. So I am almost at the verge of completion of my topic. Okay, now where is the C notepad that begins? So it's over here. But this environment is debug environment. If I want to move into my original where I had all the list of files that I had available, in that case I'll click over here. See a small right side that double arrow. I'll click it, go to C, C++. And now I am over my outline or projects, console and everything. As I said that there may be case when you all are required to work on existing projects taken up from your friends or a continuation of some work, you will require to import projects. So here are the few steps to do that. Click on project. Import existing project. Browse. Now from here you can select your program. So So in demo, suppose I want a demo project. I click on demo project, adc.pjt is project. Okay, it's showing that adc.pjt will be included to my projects list, and I will click finish. Finish. You all can see that there are two projects, I will collapse this. There are two projects that are available to me right now. The one with bold font is the project that you are working right now. What if I want to change the project that I am working? Because it is possible that there are two projects that are operating that you want to test simultaneously, one after other, to check, compare the output. Suppose you have an idle program and your program. You want to compare them. How to switch between projects? Click on the project that you want to go, right click, set as active project. Now this is bold. Point of caution, what a common error is, suppose there are two files a.c and b.c in projects capital A.pgt capital B.pgt. What sometime happens is you are editing a file in b.c, okay, which happens to be in b.pgt, but your active project is a.pgt. In that case, if you debug the steps that I told you, just debug this, it is not your code that will be debugged, it is a.pgt. This has happened at times and people were spending hours why the output is not coming. But since the two projects were similar, it was very hard to know that this was the mistake. And since the screen is right on the side, we generally minimize and we don't see, but this is important. So this is all that I had for you all to configuring your projects. Now it will be a session continuing till break about what is the difference between emulator and this simulator and normal program in JTAG.
So click on CCS 4. Now I create a new workspace. Now you see the screen, go to file, click on new, go to CCS project, type any project name. During the simulation process, there is a difference in project type. So select C6000 for this and not C2000, because simulation can use any type. Means simulation, you can see that it can be simulated. That is, you don't need to connect an external DSP for it. It will just presume that the DSP is connected and function accordingly. Then click next. Click on next. Then device variant. Device variant is a generic device because you are not using some specific device used for it. Then the next thing in device variant, you have to click generic C64X plus device. Remember this, because this will be used in another part where I will be configuring the window. And remember that device ADNS can be little or big. If you change here to big, in other one point, I will tell you where you have to change. But remember, let it be as it is for now. That is the little. Then click on finish. Then double click on the welcome. You will see the project has been created. Now right click on the project. Go to build properties. Then you get the C++ build. Again in this, you have to go to C2000 linker. I'll do this, right click, then go to build properties. You can go from properties also, but that's another method. You can go to build properties. in this you go to 6000 linker and then the basic option, just like last time we chewed it, and enter the stack size as 0x400. Click on apply and OK. Done up, you know? Then again right click on it and go to open target configuration. So we have not configured the target up till now. So just click, do you want to click? Yes. So I'll keep the name as it is. The extension should be .ccxml. Click on finish. .ccxml. So now click on Texas Instrument Simulator. That is the connection, because now we are using the simulator mode. And then in the device, you have to select the generic 64 plus which we have selected previously. That is this. You will see C64 plus mega module cycle accurate simulator little radial. Here, if you have changed during the configuration, if you have used big, then you have to select the big radial. Now, previously we have used little, therefore, you have to select the little radial now. Just write it down, the thing which you have to select. Then click on save. Done up, Pila. Double click on this and you go. Now you want to create the place where you want to write your code. So right click on the project, go to new, then create a new source file. New, that is a source file. So now we are writing an embedded C code, so it has to have an extension of .c. Click on finish and you will get a environment where you can write your code. So done up till now. So now what we do is, in the demo project which we have created, I have created 2-3 programs. I will explain to you previously and that we show how to run. So first I will show how to simulate a sine wave. So just double click on it. Copy the whole thing. So I have written this code. So it has hash include stdio.h, hash include mat.h, because we are using the sine function which is internally available. Now I have defined an integer t double bm pi accordingly, and double plot of 100. What is the double plot of 100? This is the array in which I will be storing my sine wave. Because sine wave is not just one value. I want to see whether the sine wave is being generated or not. So I am using a buffer, that is a plot. And in the void, I have written a while one. Why is a while one written? Because in any embedded C application, the thing should run infinitely. So we always write a while one there. Now I have defined VM as 5. VM is the voltage peak which I will be getting of the sine wave. The PI is the pi, 3.14. Frequency is 50 Hz. Omega is 2 pi f. And starting is t is equal to 0, because in every, if I have a buffer of 100, I will be storing from 0 to 99. So I have to start from t equal to 0, and in the while t less than 100, because I have defined a buffer of 100. So I have to write t less than 100, not equal to 100, because if you write equal to, that will be 101st value. So it will give an error, because you have started from t equal to 0, you have to write t less than 100, so that 0 to 99 will have 100 values. And in while, I have written plot t is vm into sin omega t and t plus plus. So it will store the value of sin accordingly in the plot buffer. So everyone, done up till now, clear. So now we click on the debug button. Now simulate has been new, so it has been modified and we want to save the changes. Click yes. So now the loading has been done. Now we will click on run. So we run the code. and then pause after some time. Now, how will we see the graph of the sine wave? So, please write the procedure for it. Click on tools, then go to graph. See, in graph you have so many options. You have single tank, you have dual tank, FFT magnitude, complex FFT and FFT waterfall. So these are all the digital signal processing which they have given as a feature where you can use all these graphs to analyze some values. So if you, you want to analyze the FFT of sine wave or cosine wave, you can do by this. Now we'll just see a single time graph that is of the sine wave. Click on the single time graph. Now the graph property will be defined here. So please write it down. The acquisition that buffer size. Acquisition means the number, the buffer which we have defined in our dot C should be same or less than the value which is defined. You can't acquire more than what you have defined previously. So I will put it as 100 because our buffer was 100 size. The display data size. Even if you have acquired 100, you can display only one value, two values or 50 values depending on you. So now it can be, it should never be greater than the acquisition buffer size. So it can be equal to it. Now I will put 100 there. Then the display data type. Display data type is the thing which we have used here. Now we have used the double. The double is the 64 bit floating point. So here the display data type should always be 64 bit floating point. If you select any other thing, you will not get the proper output and you will be wondering why, what is the issue. So the display data type should be same as which you have used in your code. Now the index increment is 1, means after every one sample, that is T++, it will plot. We don't have the sampling hertz now. And the start address, this is very important. In normal, see how we write in terms of pointers. We first write the ampersand sign. So put the ampersand sign in the start address and then write the name of the variable. So what is the name of the array? That is plot. So write the name properly because P is capital. So P, T. And there are many changes which can be done. See, you have line graph, bar graph. So now I keep it as line. And the time display, that is the x-axis, can be changed to millisecond, microsecond or sample. Now I keep it as sample. The grid can be changed to major grid or minor grid. Now we click on OK. So now we see that the sign has been internally generated. You just double click on it and you can see a sign of 50 Hz has been generated. Right. So now if we, I want to change the display properties, I want to analyze it properly. So what I do is right click on the graph and you go to display as. Now you know that sine, it is a buffer, so it is not actually connected with how it is shown. It is just one point by point which is plotting. Now we can see by going to display size, just click on small, you can see. So these are the 100 points which it has been stored in that buffer. So actually by showing it, it is just connecting it because we had selected the connecting line. You can see display as vertical line. So vertical line is the number of samples through which it is just shown. So you can change the display properties of the graph. So display properties, you can go to right click and display properties. Change, make changes in the axis, that is the color, the scale, display format. It can be used for GUI purposes. But for now, we will keep it as this. So everyone got it, how to do simulation. I just run one more code and show you how it is there. So now, we will go to again the demo which we have created. It's the SPWM code which I have created. Just listen for a moment. So in this, now I'll tell you the algorithm for this. can see, I have generated actually a sine wave. So sine wave is having very less frequency, and then there is a triangular wave. It is having higher frequency than that of sine. And then I am just comparing these two values and then producing output as 1 and 0. So you can write it as you want. I have considered a logic as, if the value of triangle is greater than that of sine, the output of some other buffer will always be high, right? And then if the sine value is greater than that of triangular, then the value will be low. So in this way, I generate a variable PWM wave. So what is a variable PWM? You all know that what is PWM means, some duty cycle you use just 50% of the duty cycle, that is called a PWM. But what is a variable PWM? In the next cycle, if I change the duty cycle and if I continuously keep on changing, that is, it is variable, that is called a variable PWM. So now this code is called as a SPWM, that is a sine PWM. Why it is called? Because it is varying up according to the sine values. And this, if you again do some processing, you can revive the sine wave which you have used for this process, right? So this is called a SPWM, that is a sine PWM. So now we'll analyze the code. So I have defined, initialize the buffer, that is float of x 500. So I have a buffer size of x of 500, y 500, m 500 and s 400. Then I have initialized some integers and float values. So just write down this formula. Actually, in the previous we have used internal math function to generate a sine wave. These two lines is very important to generate sine wave using the Euler's formula. So just write it down. The M and the C. The M buffer will hold the sine value and the Y buffer will hold the cosine value. So this is the Euler's formula to generate a sine wave without using the math function. You just write it down. And the frequencies of the sine wave are decided accordingly, according to the FS and the DT, which you have specified previously, the FS and the DT. They decide the frequency of the sine accordingly. So clear up till now? Zoom. These two buffers are interdependent on each other. The M uses the previous value of Y and also the previous value of F, and Y uses the previous value of Y and also the current value of F. You can see. So now we go back to the code. Therefore, I have written C is less than equal to 500. So it is showed 500 values of sine and cosine here. Then this is the logic which I have developed for writing a triangular code, for developing a triangular code. Because you never get a triangular code in any math function. If you open MATLAB or Scilab, you never get a triangular code. So the triangular code is has been developed by me. So if you want, I'll explain the logic later. So just understand that I have developed a sine wave. Triangular wave, which is having a frequency of 50 kilohertz, and the sine is having some frequency of 50 hertz. So there is a vast difference between the two. So now we'll go towards the comparison. So there is a comparer buffer of 400. and the value of sine is greater than that of triangle, then the next buffer, that is the S, will be 1. That is according to the logic which I have written. And if it else, if it is not greater, then it will be minus 1. So clear about the code. Now we'll just run the code. So it has been modified. So yes. Now it is running perfectly. Now we'll run the code. We'll pause it. Now we'll see the values in the graph. So go to tools, graph, single time. So now the acquisition buffer is 500. The display size will be 500. And remember, the display data size is to be now 32 bit float. Why? Because previously I was using double, now I will be using float value. Therefore, I will select here 32 bit floating point. And the starting address of my sign is ampersand of M. So I will run. So this is the sign. Just wait a second. So as you can see, the sine and triangle have been generated. I'll see accordingly why the buffer is not being full. So the triangle is being generated accordingly, and the sine which was shown, I'll show it. Compare the two waveforms. Eradicate any file which is being loaded into the net. So there will be no files which will be eradicated by the quick any antivirus which you are using. The second is, you will face issues of .ebss, something called as .ebss. Now I want to give you a generalized example. Like, many people write codes in MATLAB, right? Many people write codes in MATLAB and other software, where then what they do is that code they run properly there and then show the output. And to convert that code to a real time, then we put this on the DSP chip, so that you can literally prove that the code of MATLAB is physically working on the DSP. But what happens in MATLAB? In MATLAB, when you define an array, you can define an array of infinite number of elements, right? You can write one colon dash. So the colon dash will have the value any day. If you have 500 values, it will assume 500. But in the real time operation, you can't use any number of buffers. The heap size which you have defined, 0x40, is the limit up to which you can only use any buffer. So if you use extra buffers, as in you can see this code, So here see, I have used how many buffers? 1, 2, 3, 4. So 4 buffers of 3 500 each and 1 400. If I increase one of the buffers to 600 or 700, it will give me an error of .EPSS. Why? Because the size available on this is very less. Why? Because we are storing in RAM. As we know that this is not flash. Because it is not flash, the memory available, that is where we are storing is RAM, it is very less available and you have to run within the constraints. So it has to be a developer's point of view, how we have to convert an array to variables and then use the variables as an array accordingly. So that's the outlook of a developer, which we did in the last 1 year. Our project was based on that. So the only way in which you can increase the size if you want to increase the number of buffers is by flashing the code. So in for flashing the code also here, you will require very, it's a very delicate process, because even if you use, even if you go wrong in one step during flashing the process, it automatically locks the DSP and you can't permanently use it. So it's very important, you have to take care of such issues. Then you have issues of the target configuration. So even if you are running in emulator mode, you have connected the DSP and you are using an emulator mode. You want to use it in emulator mode, but you are using the simulator, that is C6000. This is C2000 and it will not be compatible with the C6000. So you have to take care of the target configuration. Also the target connection. What sometimes happens is there will be a loose contact between this USB and the USB port we have connected here. So whenever you will be loading code, you will get an error of 151 target connection, something like this. So what you have to do is you close the Code Composer Studio fully and again just reconnect it and then start the Code Composer Studio. Because what Code Composer Studio generally does, as of CCS4, what it does is it loads first the contents of all this. So first when you connect this and you start the CCS, it will first load the contents of all the CCS onto it and then start the code. So what will happen is many a time you will start CCS and then you will connect the DSP and you will get so many errors, then you will not be able to debug. So this all errors we have known over a period of time because we have worked on it. Okay, so take that into consideration. Now I will tell you the difference between C2000, C5000 and 6000. So these are the three classes of DSP TI has developed. So C2000 generally has a very advanced ADC in it. So ADC is actually 80 nanoseconds, it takes one sample, which is very good, you know. 80 nanoseconds for one channel means if you use 3 or 4 channels, you just multiply it by it. No other processor will do as fast as it. If you, even if you take FPGA does not have an inbuilt ADC in it, you have to use an external ADC. Whenever you start using an external peripheral, it has its own limitation. It will have a lesser number of samples per cycle, and also what will happen, the data transfer between an external ADC to your chip, it will also take some time. So the ADC which we have found out here, and we have proved that every sample is being taken at 80 nanoseconds. This is the best thing because it is has the inbuilt ADC. Also, it has an EPWM block, that is the enhanced PWM block. This enhanced PWM block is being used because so that you can produce PWM to the very precise value. That is, if you consider any compare resistors of Atmega32, it will have a maximum value of only 256. But here the compare resistors will be of some value, maximum will be 4096, that is 12 bits. So the resolution increases, the accuracy of the PWM comparatively increases. Now when you go to C5000, C5000 is being mainly used for audio processing and C6000 is used for video processing. So that are majorly different two applications. This C2000, as it has a fast ADC, it is being used for all the real-time processing, and in our project, we are using it for controlling the power, the algorithm for induction heating. So you can just imagine the power of this controller. And induction heating is such a large machine, and just the algorithm will be controlled by this one DSP.
So first we'll look at a simple program which will be executed on the DSP board. Okay, till now you have worked only with simulation. That means your code was only running inside your computer, and the results produced are also shown on this computer itself. But in this session you learn how to download the code on that board and execute it on it. Okay, so first we look at a simple program, that is binary counter. So to implement the binary counter, just look at your board. You can see four LEDs on one corner. They are LED 1, LD 1, LD 2, LD 3 and LD 4. So what we'll be doing is these four LEDs will display numbers from 1 to 15 in binary format. So you might be knowing what is a binary format, where numbers are represented as a sequence of ones and zeros. So suppose you are writing 10, 10 is represented as 1010. So if a bit is 1, then the corresponding LED will glow. And if the bit is 0, then the corresponding LED will not glow. Okay? So let me tell you what the code does. So initially you are setting a variable known as counter to 0. And by this statement you are initializing the system. And we are not going to use any interrupts in our code. So we disable all interrupts. And this function GPIO underscore select, what it does is it configures the direction of all general purpose input output pins, whether they are used as input or output. So this function has been given over here. So when I do GPIO control registers dot GPA mux dot all equal to 0, it means that all the GPIO pins belonging to that particular multiplexer will be configured as general purpose inputs and outputs. Because what you have in this board is that one particular set of GPIO pins will be used for multiple purposes. Like one will be used as to get an ADC signal, and some other will be used to output some other signal. But when you do when you set the MUX to zeros, then it means that it will be just used as general purpose inputs and outputs. Okay, and there is one more function, GPADIR. So what this does is that it configures whether the pin will be used as an input or an output. Now, when I'm setting a particular GPIO pin, in this case it's GPIO 9 to 1, it means that particular pin will be used as an output. Okay, and when I'm setting a particular pin to 0, that means that the pin will be used as an input. Okay, so in our code, the LEDs which are used correspond to the pins GPIO 9, 11, 34 and 39. So what you need to do is to just set the pins to output 0 or 1 and the LEDs will glow accordingly. Okay, so let me now explain you this code. So what we are doing is we are sequentially incrementing the counter by one value, and after that we are checking the individual bits of a counter, and accordingly we are toggling the LEDs. Now let me give you an example. Okay, suppose I have 9. To display 9 on these LEDs, I'll refer to the binary representation. Okay, so first what it will do is compare and this value with 1. Now all of you know that 1 is represented in binary form as 0001. So when I add it, I will get 1, which is a non-zero value. So what it does is, it sets the GPIO 9 pin to high value. And that's why my LED will glow. Okay. And next, I will compare this same value with binary 2. And you know that binary 2 is 0010. Okay. Now, when I compare this with binary 2, I will add them both, I will get all zeros. So when I get all zeros, I'll execute the else part of that if statement. So that will clear the GPIO 11 pin. So that's why the second LED won't glow. Okay, and similarly, when I add 4 with this value, I'll again get a 0 value. So I'll clear the GPIO 34 bit. So that's why I get the third LED also won't glow. Now when I finally add it with 8, then it will again give me a non-zero value. So that's why the statement corresponding to if block is executed and the GPIO pin 49 will be set to high value. So that's why you have a pattern where the first and the last LEDs glow and the LEDs at the center don't glow. So in this way you can represent all numbers from 1 to 15. because as we know, all numbers from 1 to 15 just require 4 bits. So we can use 4 LEDs to represent all of them. So this is one of the simple programs. And in this we have one more component, which is a delay loop routing. So what we do is we execute a statement known as no operation. So this no operation just skips one machine cycle. Okay. So what we do is we give some high value to this, we pass some high value as parameter to this function, and we have internally we increment the variable I up to that value and do not carry out any operation. So that means that you will get a considerable pause between two states of these LEDs. So you can clearly see what numbers are being displayed by those LEDs. Okay. Now many of you might not be understanding what these statements mean. Okay, so actually they are C constructs. You might know what are structures and unions in C. So this these statements are made up of nested structures and unions. That means GPB clear is an is a member of GPIO data RAGS structure. Bit is a member of GPB clear structure. So this is just a sequence of nested structures that we are using. And what we do is during the time of linking, we have a special file known as linker command file over here. Okay, this one. So what we do over here is we map those structures. Structures to appropriate addresses within the board. So that's why while executing, the instructions corresponding to those structures will be loaded at the appropriate location within the board. That's how you get a mapping between those structures which have been declared over here and the actual registers used in my board. So that was all about binary counter. So next we'll move to an important program, that is the ADC program. Okay, now ADC is an important part of all your applications. When we use DSP, the operations are mostly performed by using difference equations. So what we have in difference equations that we have a set of sample values, and we evaluate other values in the sequence using those sample values. So to obtain those sample values in the first place, we need to have an ADC in our peripheral circuitry. So let me show you how this works. Okay, so the basic structure of any ADC, okay, it consists of many input channels and a single output channel. So this output channel, at the output channel you get a digital word corresponding to the inputs which you apply over here. And every ADC has two important signals, that is start of conversion and end of conversion. Okay, this start of conversion signal just triggers the ADC to start a conversion operation, and the end of conversion signal is obtained to indicate that operation has been completed. Okay, in our ADC, what we are using is the end of conversion signal triggers an interrupt, and within that interrupt you carry out additional processing for your signal. Okay, so these are some of the basic facts about an ADC. So it, what it does is it converts the input analog voltage into the corresponding digital word. And in the components of ADC, you have a sample and hold circuit, a quantization circuit, and encoder. So sample and hold circuit samples the input voltage at discrete time instance and produces a discrete time signal. Now when this discrete time signal is passed through a quantization circuit, it is approximated to only some pre-decided voltage levels. So at the output of the quantizer, you get a quantized input signal. This quantized input signal is applied to an encoder, which generates a sequence of bits for every level that is applied at its input. So this is the basic functioning of an ADC. Now we have certain famous ADCs available in the market. So this ADC uses successive approximation technique. Okay, so what happens in this is the input value is compared to a reference analog value, and depending on the difference between those values, I am setting the digital bits to certain levels. And this process goes on continuously, and ultimately we have the digital word corresponding to the input signal at the output of successive approximation register. And the other type of ADC is flash-type ADC. This is faster than the previous one. So what it does is it uses a chain of comparators, and it compares the input signal against some predecided voltage levels. The output of those comparators are applied to an encoder, and depending on the outputs of these comparators, you get binary output corresponding to some bits at the output depending on the resolution of that ADC. Okay, now I'll move on to the actual ADC which is used in our DSP. So what we have over here is 16 channels. You can see in the slide we have ADC in A0 to A7 and ADC in B0 to B7. And these 16 channels are applied to two sample and hold circuits. The A channels are applied to sample and hold A, and the B channels are applied to sample and hold B. But the drawback of this ADC is that it can convert only one channel input at a time. And it even has 16 registers. These 16 registers store the results corresponding to the input channels that are applied to it. Okay, and for the operation of ADC in synchronization with the board, I need to apply some clock from my DSP to the ADC module. And as I had explained in this part, we have start of conversion signals for this ADC. Now there are three choices for the start of conversion. The first choice is via a software start of conversion. So what it does is we have a register in our DSP. We need to set one bit in that register. So as soon as the bit is set, the ADC will be triggered and it will start the conversion. Our next trigger source is EPWM. Now I won't go much into the details of EPWM, but just understand that it produces pulse waves. So these pulse waveforms are applied to the trigger input of my ADC module. And whenever there is a rising edge or a falling edge, as we program it, the ADC will be triggered. And there is one more source, which is an external signal applied via a GPIO pin. But in our program, we are using EPWM trigger. So we won't discuss the software trigger and the external input trigger. Okay, then there are additional modes of operation of ADC. Now when I talk of modes of operation for this DSP, I can program it as a combination of three modes. Okay, the modes which can be selected are sequencer mode, then sequential mode, and start mode. So each of these parameters can take different values, and we use a combination of parameter values to know what the actual how the actual conversion is being carried out by this ADC. So in this sequencer parameter, we have two options. Either it is cascaded or it's dual sequencer. Okay. So first, let me tell you what is a sequencer in our circuit. So sequencer is basically a queue of locations. So what these locations are also numbered. So the first location is 1, 0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on up to 16. Okay, so to these locations you can assign certain ADC channels. Suppose I have ADC channels from 0 to 16. I have 16 ADC channels in all. So if I assign channel 2 to 0, channel 3 to 1 location, channel 4 to 2 location, then when I apply the start of conversion to this ADC, the channel 2 will be sampled first. Then channel 3 will be sampled. Then channel 4 will be sampled. And so on. So just by applying a single trigger, I am able to obtain outputs corresponding to a large number of channels by using this sequencer. Okay? So when we use a cascaded sequencer, we are using all 16 locations of that sequencer. But when we use dual sequencer mode, I am dividing this sequencer into 2 8 location sequencers. So the first sequencer will number from 0 to 7, the next will be numbered from 8 to 15. Sorry, this is 15. Now this array is of type 32 bit floating point, so I select that. Then for start address, put an ampersand symbol, then write the name of that array. Okay? And the display data size is same as the acquisition buffer size. Okay, now just click over here. Floating point numbers.
is actually, this is the sine wave, but what is happening is we reinitialize the buffer again and again. As I have told you before, you can't use a buffer which is some having some thousand space or something. So we have only 500 values. So what is it is doing is, when 500 values are full, it gets reinitialized to the new value. So the thing which you see from here to here, so you can know that when 500 buffer, the value 500 buffers are full, immediately it reinitializes to a new value and then the sine wave starts.
There is an abrupt discontinuity while switching from 500th value to again the starting value of that buffer. Okay, but you can verify that the program is running properly from the output of this DSO. It is showing the same wave which you are applying to the ADC of this DSO. Okay, so that's all about the ADC program used to used in our DSP. Okay.